thank all the dignitaries on the stage for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to talk about the factors affecting astigmatic outcomes in SICS. As my previous speaker already mentioned, we all aim at giving 6-6 vision, whether it be cataract with SICS or phaco. And as SICS surgeons, what factors we need to consider? So actually, SICS, we can aim at giving 6-6. That is, we can take care of the pre-op astigmatism. What do we do? Why isn't it working? Next format. Yeah, okay. So there are so many factors. One is the pre-existing astigmatism and what we as surgeons induce, that is by using cautery, by incision character, and the suture characteristics as well. So pre-existing astigmatism, how do we correct it? We actually have to have a good keratometry reading initially. So, and then we can place the incision at the steepest meridian. And also we have to play on the wound characterization. So cautery, we definitely need a very clear field to operate. So this can be achieved by using a good cautery. So how do you do a good cautery? It is always advisable to use a wet field bipolar cautery rather than using a unipolar or a thermal ballpoint cautery. And always make sure you just cauterize the bleeders rather than running on the conjunctiva in a random fashion. Just cauterize the bleeders and please avoid the blue zone. And make sure you nicely withdraw the tenons before making the incision and the cautery as well. So when you char the tenons, what happens is you're going to have irregular edges and the incision is not going to be good. And when you use too much of cautery, it can cause scleral shrinkage and scleral necrosis, which can cause high induced astigmatism. And always cauterize before you make the incision. If you make the cautery after the incision, what happens is you'll have fish mouth and you'll have wound gaping as well. And coming to the incision, you have to decide on the location, the size, shape, and the configuration of the wound. So location, as I already mentioned, using the keratometry, we can decide on whether to have a superior or a temporal incision. Temporal incision is supposed to be good. But one disadvantage with temporal incision is you need to make sure your wound integrity is good and also you make sure that you close it with the conjunctiva well. If you're going to have exposure of the wound, it can lead to complications such as endophthalmitis in the post-op period. When you have a superior incision, the upper lid actually takes care of that part. But when you're going to have a temporal incision and if you don't close it well, you can end up in a lot of trouble. So if your wound is going to be more anteriorly located, you're going to induce more astigmatism. So these are some pictures that show different types of external configuration of the wound. So the external configuration of the wound largely depends on the size of the nucleus. So if you're going to have a grade 3 to 4 nucleus, you cannot make a small incision. We definitely have to make something bigger than 6 millimeters incision. So the first one that you see here, this is the smile, the straight frown, and the V or the inverted V or the chevron incisions. So most of us prefer the frown or the inverted V chevron incisions for two reasons. What we have to know here, there are two entities to a incision. One is the chord length and one is the arc length. So what is arc length? The incision size that traverses, what you trace throughout the length of the incision. This is the arc length. Whereas the chord length is from the point of the initiation of the incision to the end. So this will be your chord length and this will be your arc length. So when your chord length is going to be less, then your astigmatism is also going to be less. Same thing with inverted V, your chord length is less. And the other thing is the edges of the incision are placed away from the limbus. So again, your astigmatism is going to be less. Whereas in the smile incision, you can see that the edge is very close to the limbus. So that's why we prefer a frown or an inverted V or a chevron incision. So again, the internal configuration. So when you go into the cornea, make sure you don't go too much into the cornea. A 0.5 millimeters is okay. More than that, you're going to induce a lot of astigmatism. Always make sure you do not go in a sawing manner. You just have to make a straight cut because that can cause irregular edges and again it can cause astigmatism and you can also have your wounds is not going to be very good. Here we always prefer a triplanar incision as in the second picture. So it is a three planar incision. The first plane, you make the tunnel groove. The second plane, you dip. And then the third plane, you go in with a keratome. So when you make a two-planar incision, biplanar incision, you're not going to have good wound stability. And again, that is also going to induce some amount of astigmatism. So this concept of incisional funnel, the incisional funnel zone is called as the neutral zone. It was actually, it was described by one Paul Koch in the year 1991. So this area is, it is supposed to be a neutral zone where you don't have any astigmatism. So this is an imaginary line. It is a curved line that is drawn from the limbus away. So as you see, this incision, though it is within the funnel, it is too small for the nucleus to come out. The smile and the straight incision always tend to be outside the funnel, whereas the frown and the inverted chevron lies inside the funnel. So this will always lead to lesser astigmatism. So what we have to remember is astigmatism is directly related to the cube of length, and it is inversely related to the distance from the limbus. So and also the configuration of the wound helps in getting better results. Suture characteristics. SICS, we actually say that it is a sutureless surgery most of the times, but at times when suture is warranted, we need not shy away in applying a suture, one or two sutures, because our you know, patient safety is more important than, you know, saying that I'm a proud SICS surgeon, I don't use sutures. I think things like endophthalmitis and all that we have to take care of. So suture characteristics, the length, depth, tightness, suture material, and suture orientation definitely play a role. So in case you're applying more than one suture, then you have to keep this in mind. When the length of the suture, when you're having two, three sutures, when the length of the suture is equal to the distance between the two sutures, then you will have, you'll have a good wound and there will not be any astigmatism. But when your length is not equal to the distance, when you're going to have closely placed sutures, you're definitely going to induce withdrawal astigmatism. And when your length and your distance between two sutures is great, definitely the wound integrity is not going to be good. And again, you're not taking care of the astigmatism part there. So the tightness of the suture, make sure you make a good suture, suture it, and always make sure you bury the suture. Too tight suture, you will know that you will not be able to move the suture. You'll have radial folds on the cornea. Whereas a loose suture, you can just move it easily, and it will not take care of the astigmatism as well. So when you form your wound and when you put a nice suture, you will be able to move it easily and you'll be able to bury it. That means your suture is tight enough when you don't have the radial folds as well. So this is just a picture to depict it. And depth of suture, always make sure you take it at least 90% depth. Too superficial will cut through the tissue and thereby cause astigmatism. So again, non-absorbable sutures will cause lesser astigmatic, less against the rule decay. And suture orientation, they should always be radial. And so to summarize, so pre-existing astigmatism can be corrected using good, good keratometry readings and taking care of the incisions. Thank you very much.